Good evening, and welcome to the October 14th, 2008 School Board Meeting. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Alan, are there any adjustments to the agenda?
I do not have any adjustments, no.
Okay. Approval of school board minutes from September 9th, 2008. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the school board minutes as presented for the meeting on Tuesday, September 9th.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any errors, omissions, changes? No? Seeing none, all in favor? 6-0. Okay, comments by student representatives. We have some in the audience, okay?
Hi, I'm Hannah Deneen from the middle school. And to begin, I'd like to announce all school closings. On October 23rd, there's a half day, followed by no school on October 24th due to teacher conferences. Also, there will not be any school November 3rd, 4th, and 11th. Hero Stories is an event created by the Middle School World Language Committee, which allows families and students from Cape Elizabeth to hear the journeys of many amazing immigrants and how they came to Maine. This will be on October 16th from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock at Community Services and will include guests from Ethiopia, Samoa, Germany, and Bulgaria. And then this year, the fall play, directed by Mr. Steve Price and Mr. Evan Solander, is a series of three Edgar Allan Poe stories told by the middle school, grades 5th through 8th. And it opens on November 7th at 7 o'clock, and then a second show will be on November 8th at 7 o'clock, followed by a show on November 9th at 2 o'clock. And then the middle school book fair will go on the week of October 20th, and this year we're having a special book fair cafe night on October 22nd. And the yearbook cover contest is going on now. This is where middle school students can design their own yearbook cover and submit it to the yearbook committee and have a chance to have their design on the cover of the 2008-2009 yearbook and receive a free yearbook of their own. And this is due October 17th. Or this Friday. And then all winter sports are starting October 27th. This includes girls basketball, indoor track, and ice hockey. To find out more, you can contact Community Services, which the middle school sports run through now, and or you could register online. And then lastly, I'd like to announce the middle school student council started last Thursday, and the first middle school dance is to be held on October 23rd.
Thank you. Questions or comments for her? No, I guess not. Thank you. Sorry. Can we hear from the high school folks?
Yes. Some comments on the SAC, which is the Student Advisory Council. Recently, we've really been looking to kind of revamp the way the SAC runs and works. Over the past 2 years, I think students have definitely noticed a decrease in productivity from the SAC, and so we've been trying to change the way things are run. Recently, we've tried to educate all the members about parliamentary procedure, and we've only held one meeting since then, and using parliamentary procedure, we already found that the meetings were less chaotic, everyone was able to be heard, so that was really good. We're working on making different subcommittees, and what we hear a lot from the students is, oh, you know, I'm unhappy about this, I don't like this, but nothing ever gets done about it. And so we made a information gathering subcommittee where we're going to put out a survey where we can really just kind of hone in on what it is the students want to be changed, and we're working hard to just kind of find ways to actually work with the kids and really understand what it is they want and how we can do it. So we're definitely just trying to be a bit more productive this year.
Great. Thank you.
Sarah basically covered everything. I just wanted to add a little bit. We had a really successful, I think one of our most successful forum meetings that we've had in, I don't know, 3 or 4 years. And we had a couple of school board members, Superintendent Hawkins, and Principal Shedd to come and talk to us about, I guess, the new direction of the SAC. So it was a successful meeting, and we've kind of begun to use those new ideas in our group.
Great. Questions for them? I can tell you that we find that parliamentary procedure helps us too.
Yes.
Especially when there is disagreement. It allows everyone to be heard and a better decision to be made. So we can appreciate that. Thank you very much. Comments from public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone here from the public to speak on something that's not on the agenda? Seeing none, we will move on to recognition. Trish.
Yes, I just wanted to recognize the World Language Team at the middle school for the Hear Our Stories series that they're doing. The first one was a few weeks ago, and it was, I think, better attended than anyone anticipated. There was a great group of parents and kids. The presenters in the panel were wonderful. They were people, immigrants from Brazil and other Central American, South American countries. The next one is scheduled for this Thursday, and I would encourage anyone who is interested to attend. They did a really wonderful job in sort of organizing it and putting it together. So I think I would encourage people to attend. There's one more in November if you can't make this Thursday.
Thank you very much. Moving on to communication, upcoming board meeting dates. I know that I think the board is aware, but we've made some changes because of some holidays and so forth. So I just wanted to go over the school board meetings. Our workshops are changed. We will be having a workshop on Tuesday, October 28th on curriculum, Tuesday, November 18th on athletics, Tuesday, December 16th on goal setting, and Tuesday, January 27th on technology. Those are all at 7 o'clock at the high school library, and anyone is encouraged to attend. Those ones are not on television, but our regular meetings are being changed as well. Our November meeting will be on Tuesday, November 4th here in the chamber. Our December meeting will be Tuesday, December 2nd, and those are both at 7 o'clock. So I just wanted to make people aware of those date changes. Alan, let's talk about our schools meeting.
Yes. As many of you received notification, we have been having Let's Talk About Our Schools meetings, one with each school in the district. I had the first one on Monday, October 6th, and that was with Pond Cove. There are three times during the day when I meet with parents. One is at 7:30 in the morning, one's at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and the other is at 7:50 at night. Although there has not been a large crowd of people there, the information that has been shared is very important, and as a result of it, I've been gathering that information and taking a look at both the things that they talk about, which really are working well, and those things that they have questions about. And I will be presenting those after I've had my third set of meetings to the principals and also to the board to take a look at some of the things that have been discussed. The second one was held on Wednesday, October 8th, again at the same three times. I had a very small turnout for those, but again, I would say to you, even one person is a good opportunity for me to begin to hear and listen to things that they have to say. But it has convinced me also that I need to do this again in the spring, and hopefully we'll bring more parents out. The third one was originally scheduled for this Friday, October 17th. Then we suddenly began to look at it and thinking that a 7:15 in the evening meeting on Friday may possibly not be the most popular time. So we have changed that date to Tuesday, October 21st, and Jeff is letting his parents know from the high school, and we also are making sure it's on the website and everything. I'm hoping that we may have some good turnout from the high school. This is really an attempt by me to offer myself to listen to and discuss with people what's going on. And I would say to you that one thing that has pleased me is that one of the issues that's been brought up probably in almost every meeting I've had is questions around curriculum. And so it gave me an opportunity to explain where we are in curriculum, what we're doing with curriculum, what the process is. And it also led me to change our monthly workshop meeting for October to curriculum so that we can take a very close look and inform people about that. I am also hoping that we will be able to do something around filming this one so it can be shown on television afterwards. So we're looking into some possibilities as far as doing that. And that is basically where I am on these meetings. I also, though, am doing 3 days in October, one in each school, where I spend the entire day at the school and have a chance to talk with teachers, other people who are in the school, and also have a chance to visit classrooms. I did the high school last Friday. Tomorrow I'm at Pond Cove, and then the next one I have coming up is at the middle school. And also a good opportunity to have a chance to talk with people about what is going on, what questions they have, what concerns they have, et cetera, as we move through. And as you know, the school board is also doing meetings, early morning meetings for each school as well, to give people a chance to talk with them. So we certainly are making every effort to be out there, to be available, and to be listening to what is going on. And I would add just one more thing, is last Friday I also had an opportunity to talk to our two high school board members to talk about some things that they are going to do with us during the workshop sessions for the athletic one and for the technology one. And they're going to be providing some solid leadership in that role as well.
Oh, great. And Alan, I noticed that these meetings are also posted on the website,
town
website. And if anybody else from the public wants to attend, that's fine. It's not just for parents.
Nope.
It's
for anybody
who's interested.
One of them had a town council member go. I also had a newspaper reporter go. And I have had one person who has gone to each one of each of those who has been working somewhat in our schools but is not a hired person. And they have come to observe and also to ask questions.
Great.
So that is an opportunity they have.
Thank you. Moving on to the Ray Moulton Field sign.
Yes. I sent you a quick email after my meeting with Bob Malley to look at that sign. Unfortunately, it was slower process than I had planned on just because so many other things came up and took my attention. But we did sit down. We did go over the plan. We did look at the possibilities of the signs, where they would be placed, et cetera. We also, Bob had talked with a person who was responsible for signs in the system. So you do have a summary of what the sign will look like, what the colors will be, et cetera, and we are in the process of getting that ready. As a result of that, I will be bringing to the policy committee recommendations for a policy as far as signs are concerned on school property.
Great. Thank you, Alan. Transfer vehicle request from the police department for maintenance department use.
Yes. On September 15th, I received a letter from Michael McGovern. As you may or may not know, they were taking several police cars, unmarked police cars, off the list of police cars that we use. We're badly in need of vehicles at the maintenance department for transportation. We have the green truck. We have been able to take over the white truck for part-time, although it is also used to take things to the recycling center. So we were able to get a 2005 police cruiser out on the road, and it has worked out very well. It was a cruiser that had just had a new transmission put in, so it was in really good shape, and it was free, which is one of the best prices I find as superintendent as we move along. We do have to obviously insure it and register it. But it has taken up the slack of what we need for our maintenance crew, both from the town side and the school side, to make all of the commitments they have to all of the schools and all of the other town buildings. So this was a joint effort with Mike McGovern in order to ensure we have some way for people to travel, and it has worked out quite well.
Great. Thank you. Next, moving on, is a thank you from Margaret Welch, and I'd like to read the note that she gave to the school. It says, "Dear Cape Elizabeth School Board, I want to thank you very much for the recognition and gift acknowledging my 20 years of teaching in the district. Both are very much appreciated. It's hard to believe that 20 years have passed since I began at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. Over the years, I've moved about from one subject area and grade level to another more than once, which I've requested to keep me fresh, and I can say without reservation that I have truly loved each assignment and age group I've taught. I feel fortunate to have found my niche here at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. Thank you for all you do to support our school's students and teachers. Sincerely, Margaret Welch." Allen, retirement of a bus driver?
Yes. I give you this information about the bus driver, not for your vote, but just for informational purposes. But you do have a retirement from Barbara Smith, who will be retiring as of December 23rd, 2008, from bus driving. I think I also understood from Janet that there is a second one that is possibly coming in for December as well. Am I correct on that, Janet? Okay, so that has not been received yet. So we will be looking for bus drivers. So any of you who'd like to get a license, if you would go ahead and do that, we will get you out on the roads as quickly as possible. You sure you don't want it?
Very funny. Okay, Allen, budget review schedule?
Yes. As you know, I have been fairly careful and not started budget too early this year. The administrators did not need the same schedule as they had last year beginning September 1st. So we have working a little slower, also doing that because we are very much aware of things that are happening at the federal and state level as far as finances are concerned. However, there is a time coming when we have got to take a look at the budget process. What I have sent to you, attached to a brief letter, is a draft of a calendar of budget hearings and budget plans. I met with Michael McGovern the other day. I went over the plans that he was writing for the town council. I do not think the town council has accepted this schedule yet, so all of this is only draft. But I know also you like to get dates as soon as possible so that you can look at them and we can make any decisions about changes. So that is a draft copy. If you would review it, if you have any questions, to let me know so that we can work our way through getting that accepted. At the same time, I do ask you as a board to plan on meeting with me and with the administrators to look at the budget process for this year. I have just forwarded on to you this evening from the Department of Education a letter informing us about the major cuts that are going to be coming at the state level. And they're talking about initially a 10% cut in each department, and it could get larger. But what they're looking at right now is we will probably at the least get frozen at 2009 amounts of money. And they are also talking about other ways that we may be affected by this. I'm also looking at what is going on federally, obviously, as we all are, as far as the stock market is concerned, et cetera, and what effect that is having on many people. So I would like to find a time when we can sit together with the administration and discuss budget for next year, with the understanding that this past year, although there are people who still question it, we began this past year with a 12.2% budget. That was based on a request that several of you on the board had to look at a budget based on what is truly needed for the school system. And the request was that I not cut that budget when it initially came to you. After that, we looked at the budget and you had to make some difficult decisions as far as setting limits on the budget. And if you remember correctly, we moved through several steps in order to do that, which did have an effect on what we were able to do in order to maintain the school system. Fortunately, I was able to move through the final budget and not make too many cuts, the biggest cut financially being the curriculum director, also recognizing the cost of energy and how they were rising all the time. But this year, we need to work together to determine how we're going to budget, what we want to budget for. I've had a couple of side discussions with some of you talking about some pieces that you'd like to look at, anywhere from looking at specific areas of the budget and looking at more or less a zero base and how is that working. And so those are pieces that I think we are going to need to move forward on. Population figures, I've already had requests from many people to look at population figures, and I will tell you, if you look at the document in the front of your budget, of your school board agenda tonight, you will see that we have dropped 38 students this year. So that is another drop. What I look at is that the middle school has picked up students. I think they got 19 more than they had last year at this time, but both the high school and Pond Cove have seen drops in their population. So those are issues we will be looking at. And I am putting together a document which shows every single classroom, how many students there are in that classroom per teacher, and also looking at the teacher leader program and how many of the teacher leaders we have and what type of work they do in that process. So I am beginning to gather data to get ready for discussions with you about a budget for 09-10 and what that will look like. So I decided that tonight was a night to send out this initial information. I recognize the fact that after November 4th, we will be looking at least one change on the school board, if not more. And so I want to be well prepared as we move into budget season to be able to look at all of the possibilities.
Thank you. Ann, when you say we've dropped, what are you comparing?
I'm comparing October 07 with October 08.
Okay. Because I was looking at from last month,
no.
September to October, we actually added four students.
Yeah, no, but if you look at it from, there's an October 07 and October 08, it'll show that we have dropped 22 students at the high school, we have added 19 at the middle school, and we have dropped 29 at the high at Pond Cove for a total drop of 32 students.
Okay. I just wanted to know what time frame you were looking at.
So. Yeah, no, I was looking October to October.
Okay, thank you. Questions?
Yeah, just quickly, I'm wondering, you mentioned that you would like us to get together with the administrators. Do you have a time in mind?
I haven't yet. I am having a meeting with the administrators October 28th, I think it is. And that's where we're going to have some initial discussion, and so then I will be in contact with you and to set up a time in November so that we can sit down and begin to take a look at that.
Thank you.
Other questions? Bus update. Janet? Thank you.
To speak to you on the incident that occurred at the workshop evening on September 23rd, which was a bus that was transporting volleyball students from a evening in Augusta, broke down on I-295. Basically, what happened in simple terms is that a valve broke, which blew a piston, which caused us to have to rebuild the engine. According to our maintenance department at Public Works, it's one of the toughest engines around, and this is something that doesn't ever happen.
Good to know.
So, Alan also, I believe, wanted to make sure that it was noted all of the people and the situations that were handled by the textbook for the most part. The bus driver at the time was Nate Maxwell, who handled the situation both technically and procedurally by the textbook, did an excellent job. The volleyball coaches at the time handled the students and the situation perfectly. In fact, how they were able to get the Richmond Fire Department and police to deliver pizza to the school bus on the side of the road, I'm not sure, but somehow they were able to get them to do that. So we thank also Richmond Fire Department and Police Department for going above and beyond the call of duty, not only responding to the emergency, but also pizza delivery. Steve LaRose, who I called to leave the confines of his wonderful home that evening to get in a bus and drive up there to get the students that were stranded on the side of the road. And Steve Young, who I called to evaluate the situation from his home, called Nate, asked him all the technical questions that needed to be asked, evaluated the situation, and then we figured out which company to call to then tow the bus back down here to Cape Elizabeth. South Portland Transportation Department, who has loaned us a bus since then because we've been short a bus and can't take care of our own transportation needs. Then, of course, our own Public Works maintenance staff, which is Eric Olson and Sean McHugh, who not only had to take the entire engine apart evaluate what exactly had gone wrong, but then figure out the most cost-effective way to get the bus back on the road, which I believe today was the first day it went back on the road. And we had everything from completely trashing the bus, which we couldn't do because we can't afford to do that, to buying a brand new engine, which I believe was in the vicinity of about $14,000, to securing a variety of used and new parts and being able to rebuild the whole thing, which, if I'm correct, is going to cost us in the vicinity of $5,000 to $6,000. So they have really gone to bat for us to do a lot of hard work to get us at the most cost effective. And then special thanks go out to Pat Fowler from our office, who has done everything short of pulling a bus out of her hat to make sure that the transportation continues to run and operate. It's been quite a job to get everything from the bus runs on a regular basis to all of the athletic trips and the extracurricular activities to and from their events. So certainly that one incident on September 23rd changed a lot of situations. So thanks to all of them. Also in front of you, I put the proclamation from the governor stating that Bus Safety Week, which is October 20th to the 24th, on top of that is the 24th of October is he has proclaimed as Bus Driver Appreciation Day. So I just got this information on Friday, so we will be doing a bunch of activities on the school buses surrounding bus safety, and we will also be acknowledging our drivers for transporting some of the most important packages that we possibly have. So thanks to them for all the work that they do on a regular basis.
Do we have any questions? Yes, Rebecca?
Jen, in terms of this bus, how old was it? Is it one of our newer or our older buses?
It's one of the buses that has a, it's not one of our new buses, but it's not certainly our oldest bus either. It's one of the ones that's in the middle of the pack. As my understanding, it not only is it one of the toughest engines, but this shouldn't have happened, and we are fortunate that the piston, excuse me, no, the valve didn't hit a different area, which would have completely taken the engine out of commission altogether.
Other questions? No? Thank you very much, Janet.
Sure, thank you.
Alan, energy conservation plan update?
Yes. At this point in the meeting, I want to do an update. And then when we get into the new business, we will be talking about the proposed energy conservation that I presented to you in the September meeting. But there have had quite a few questions about what are we doing to conserve energy. And I think probably the biggest problem is we don't do enough publicly to talk about that. So I went back to Ernie, and Ernie apologizes for not being here, but this is his vacation week, and he is doing some things he enjoys doing, and so I thought he needs to do that and take the time to do it. So what we did was we looked at a list of things that have been changes that we have made in the system since September 27, 2005. Each of these changes are changes that have helped us conserve energy. Now, at the same time, I want to be very clear. Conserving energy does not mean we've saved a lot of money, because every time we save energy, we recognize that the price of what we're doing continues to rise. So what we have done is we have shown some savings of money, but we have also seen that by the amount of energy, the lack of energy that we're using, we are saving a large amount of money that would have continued to make that budget rise. So in the booklet that I gave to you this evening, there is that list of energy management pieces and what has been done. Ernie got to thinking about it and worrying about it and making sure he had the right information. So he did do a different list. It's the same list, but he did it by dates just to give you some idea of what dates all of these things happened. And so I'm just going to pass these on to you so that you'll have them. But basically, and I also have copies for anyone out there who would like them as we finish up. But basically what he began to look at is, if you go down through this list, he looked at lighting the senior hallway and a math wing. 50% is left off unless needed. They have removed 6 fixtures in the high school lobby, installed light sensors in woodworking, classroom, art room, etc. He has rebuilt, and this is one of the things I think I mentioned to you earlier. He went over to the high school and went to room 307, which is Ted Jordan's room, which has consistently been a very cold room. And they completely rebuilt the room. They put another layer of wall within it. They also changed the heating elements. And so we are beginning to see, although winter hasn't come yet, we are beginning to see some savings there. If you go down through this list, and I certainly am not going to read it all to you, but if you know, we have been in the process of the energy audit, which has also looked at all of our buildings, both school and town, to take a look at how we spend money. It was interesting to look at this building, which is the oldest of the buildings as far as the schools are concerned. And this building is at 94% energy efficiency, which I think is pretty remarkable for a building as old as this is and the work that has gone on in here. They've reconfigured hallways. They've split lighting locker rooms. They've retrofitted all the ventilators, and so on and so forth. But there is a fairly long list of these, which I will make sure also get on the website so that people will have an opportunity to see them. You also have in your packet a document that looks at the changes in the lighting in different buildings. If you remember correctly, there was a notice come out from the, I think it was the Department of Energy, offering money as far as grants are concerned. Ernie moved very quickly, and we were the first system who got on that list. And so what Ernie has done is he has gone through buildings, not only school buildings, but town buildings, and made some major changes as far as lighting is concerned. I think one of the most noticeable ones, if you've ever used our gyms, the way the lighting was changed a few years ago, you turn the lights on and then you wait 10 minutes until the lights are completely on. They've put new lighting in there, which now comes on immediately, but it is also energy efficient lighting. So we're seeing some major savings in that. And if you look at some of these net annual savings, as you go down through the list, you will see that already in the very short time, we are beginning to see some strong possibilities as far as savings in each of those buildings. So that is another piece that Ernie has done. And this information will lead into the discussion during the second part of our meeting on new business as far as the energy conservation within our schools. And so I will refer to that as we get to that point.
Alan, if yes. I can, I'd just like to highlight the fact that through Ernie's amazing diligence, he was able to implement this program at a cost of, at basically a break-even cost within 1 year.
Exactly.
And that's pretty amazing, and I think it's worthwhile for the public to know that.
Alan, I do appreciate you putting this on the website, because I know as a board member, especially with the price of energy right now, a lot of people seem to be saying, you should be doing this, you should be doing that, and there may be some great ideas out there, but most of the time the response is, we've already done that, but they don't necessarily know that. And so this is helpful, because I know with the Finance Committee, we have talked a lot about our consumption has gone way down, even though the price per gallon of whatever has gone way up. So
yeah, I mean, the energy consumption has been a major topic of the Finance Committee for the past 3 years. It didn't just start this year, and Ernie's work started even before that. So really, he's the one who had the foresight quite a while ago to get our school district really way ahead of the curve on all of this work. So it's hard to explain to people that a lot of the work has already been done, but it doesn't mean that more work can't be done.
And ideas are always welcome, because we might have not have thought of something. Alan, update on booster meeting bleacher project?
Yes, Jeff Thorak is going to report on that, and he had a game. He said he would be here fairly soon, so if you don't mind, if we could set that aside, and when
sure.
Jeff comes in, we will talk about that.
Okay, then we'll move on to Steve Connolly and the update on the science priority learning goals.
I should mention that Steve tonight is going to do a very brief presentation on that, and then we will come back to that at the October 28th meeting to talk more about it, but just to give you some sense of where we are at this point.
Thank you, Steve.
think you all got a copy of some documents from Pond Cove Middle School and the high school priority learning goals. Is that right?
When would that have been?
Andrea. Okay. Well, how are we doing tonight? Okay. So, I thought those went out last week, so let me just catch you up to date then. The three schools have done quite a bit of work with the priority learning goals and the secondary learning goals for the three schools, aligning those to the National Science Education Standards, and then looking at the new parameters for essential instruction, and paying particular attention also to the sections in these new PEIs. Makes me feel like I'm in Canada. But parameters also tell us which ones of those will actually be tested on the MEAs. So we're looking at what those particular items are. And we have also, in the last CIA meeting, Rebecca and the team, we were talking about how people are saying, well, I've already got these learning goals down, and now we're moving on to the curriculum templates. And so the idea was, wait a minute, isn't that kind of getting the cart before the horse? But in reality, what most people are saying in the classrooms is that since I'm using these priority learning goals and I'm doing these things in the classroom now, I'm going to document what I'm doing, and that way, if I need to go back and make any changes, at least I've got something to work from. So it seems to be working out pretty well. I wanted to give you an example of the middle school, Joanne Barra's work with the curriculum map. I'm going to bet you can all read this quite clearly, but let's pretend you can't. Okay, what this map shows is, says Cape Elizabeth Middle School Science Curriculum Map. And over here in the far column are the state standards. There are five state level standards from the new parameters. And then she also has next to that the indicator labels. So you have standards, and you have the next level called performance indicators, which are more specific than the standards. She also has included into this the National Science Education Standards that we are making sure. She did a correlation between the state standard and the federal standard. Here are the parameters for essential instruction that just were approved and went into effect. So we're going to start talking about learning results. We're going to start talking about these PEIs. They went into effect November of 2007. So in these, the black section shows the ones that are required by the state, and the red shows required by the state and also tested on the MEAs. And then she's taken sections of the priority learning goals provided by Pond Cove to see where do they hit some of these areas. She's also done grade 5, 6, 7, and 8, and then secondary learning standards or learning goals that run throughout the grades 5 through 8. So you can kind of get a look at a matrix to say where do you hit some of these things. And then lastly over here, CEHS column says, and this is where they take some of the pieces that we're also working with. The only standard that when we looked at this has a blank space going across here is skills and traits of technological design. Use a design process, simple tools, variety of materials to solve problems and so forth. And actually, most of that for the middle school is covered through Chris Turner's technology program, because they are using simple machines to complex machines, using Kinect's mechanical advantage, engineering design, solar capability, alternative energy resources, ARCHICAD for kitchens and for floor plans, three-dimensional drawings. I mean, he covers a wealth of those topics, so we do have them covered just the same. We'll be meeting on November 3rd and 4th to revisit your suggestions from the, I'm going to bring any suggestions back to the team from the, October 28th, so that timing is great. We're also going to look at whatever guidelines we have from you as far as our priority learning standards, where we can continue working with the templates, and then I'm going to be dealing with the other groups on constructing curriculum maps, which is a model piece that we got from the Wayland Schools during our Project Blueprint work. And we'll also be working on constructing curriculum resource guides. That's been part of Joanne's work the last year and a half as well. She has that nearly completed at this point, to be able to say to a science teacher or a brand new science teacher, not only are these templates the kinds of things that we are, this is our curriculum, this is how it all fits into place, and this is how we maintain coherence from class to class and grade to grade at the middle school, as an example. So we are really, I think that that's a great example of what the school board has allowed us to do at the middle school with her lead teacher position. It's paid off tremendously. And we did notice again this year in the MEAs that the Cape Middle School's eighth graders, it's the only grade that's tested in science, was again tied with highest score in the state for similar size schools. You really can't compare to two or three kids on Peaks Island who took it, or a group of six kids on Vinyl Haven or something like that. So, but when comparing, we did comparisons to, for instance, Frank Harrison Middle School, which is Yarmouth, Greeley, Falmouth. I think I also did Scarborough as well. I might have missed somebody in there, and our score was tied with one of the other schools for the tops in that group, which also tended to lead the state. So, that's 2 years in a row. We're looking good.
Thank you, Steve. Questions for Steve? Comments?
Yes.
Trish?
Two questions. Eventually or ultimately, this will lead to specific curriculum topics and activities per grade that can be specifically communicated to parents.
The curriculum will be, the templates will end up actually being online so that they can be accessed by parents, by anybody, wherever you happen to be.
Okay.
You could be sitting in, 62 inches of snow today in Montana, reading those if you wanted to be, if there was power. isn't that what they had, 62 or something
okay.
like that? So, and also you would be able to, we can demonstrate it at curriculum opportunities, be able to say these are the units that we're working through now.
Okay, and my next question is, and sort of ties to budget, having sat through some grant requests at the middle school, this will drive the need for textbooks,
choice,
periodicals across the grades. So that should drive budget requests, budget decisions, and sort of tie into what we need so that it's sort of standard across the grade.
Yeah, just by example, Allison Caruso in the sixth grade, Claire Ramsbotham and Charlie Carroll, who are sharing the set of Accents on Science from 1983, that one really doesn't cover some of these topics that we're getting into yet. I don't think some of the topics were invented in 83, but we have done quite a bit of look at the hard copy editions, and we've also looked into the electronic versions. I'm very partial to the electronic versions because those stay updated all the time. We have the laptops in the 7th and 8th grades, so students would be able to have access on those at any point. We have a couple of laptop carts also for 5th and 6th grade. Plus, with the passwords, students can access those at home on home computers. So it's not going to be, once that's put in the book, it's already outdated. It's going to stay current, and you get a site license for about $70 for 7 years. So it is, it is a bit of an investment, but it's certainly, as I've talked about in the past, we have not had a textbook cycle in the middle school for 12 years. This will be going on year 13, and some of the books are as old as 25, 26 years.
But it'll be more defined, and it'll be more defined. If you have a specific curriculum, it's very obvious what the resources are that you need to meet the federal, the state, and district
and
goals.
By example, Joanne has seen a very nice correlation between the state and the new parameters. So in any of the resources that we're looking at, what have they done? They've gone by the National Science Education Standards, and they also have a piece that correlates to show you where your state standards are brought into those as well.
Trish, if I could just add a little piece of an answer. I think part of your question is a question that I've had from several parents is, let's use an example. You have seven classrooms that are third grade, just as an example. And the possibility of seven different types of teaching go on there and several different types of subjects. The purpose of the curriculum is to be sure that there is a consistent science in each grade level, and it spirals from grades K through 12 to make that happen. And what Steve just showed you there is once those are developed, there will be in every school building a wall that shows all of the curriculum areas and what is expected to be taught K through 12.
But I think it's important from a budget perspective when we get to that point that if these are the standards that we need to meet for accreditation purposes, you need certain resources. I mean, it directly links. It should be a no-brainer that these are resources we need to meet the standards that we're required to meet.
The instructional practices, the resources that we're using to access and supplement those instructional practices will get at this curriculum. You don't have the resources for kids to read. And it's kind of, people might think now that, well, just use the, you've got the laptops, just do your searches and go with your topic from there. There are certainly pieces that we can do related to that, but what we find is most of the topics, when kids go to look up something about genetics, they don't find something written on an eighth grade or a seventh grade level about dealing with Punnett squares and so forth. What they find is something written at a post-collegiate level that there's no possibility for translation for them. It's a frustrating search. It doesn't last long. But we do pick up, we do have tools. For instance, explorelearning.com has math and science gizmos that we use in most of our classes.
Here.
And I know I had the pleasure of having a sneak preview of some of what you showed us, and I love the work that I see you all doing in the middle school. I just want to make sure, and sort of marrying what you were saying, that what I'm seeing is also using that model that was shared with us at one of our workshops by the team from the CIA that came and showed us, you know, how the CIA was going to play out. I mean, because it looks like this is an example of that in action, so... Okay, and that's
encouraging.
It also allows
the English language arts one that you
right.
saw in June.
Yeah, they piloted that piece for us, so we follow that model.
And just one more comment. And you said that you were able to use, sort of as a reference, something that was done through Project Blueprint.
Yes.
And I was curious, what has happened with, are we still up and running with Project Blueprint? Is that something on...
Budgetarily?
No. Financially, this year, we could not do it. It required a trip to Pennsylvania, and the expenses of that were just out of the reach of budget after our budget was settled, because I could not manage that along with everything else we're doing. So we are not this year participating in the visit, our visits with Project Blueprint, and I have let them know that it is a budgetary issue.
And is that something, well, we can maybe bring that up another point in time, something we want to consider maybe doing, getting back into in the future?
I think any time we should consider it, but we will always have to keep track of where we are budgetarily and how that plays a role in how we see our whole school system. So there'll be many things that we'll have to take a very close look at and decide how we do it based on where we are financially.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate it. I forgot to mention to the board that Trish and Alan and I met on the agenda. We attempted to change it a little bit to streamline it so we weren't dealing with topics twice, once at the beginning and once in the new business. So we tried to do a little streamlining. So I don't know how you folks are finding it, but do let us know if you think it's working, not working, or suggestions for improvement so that we're not repeating ourselves. That was our attempt. So anyway, moving on to new business. Alan, do you want to talk about...
I'm looking at 7B, which is the varsity baseball team trip to Orlando, Florida, because I do have three people here. I keep hoping Jeff will come in because I know he was going to play a role in that too. But because the energy conservation plan could take a long time or it could be done very quickly, I thought perhaps what we could do is go to 7B, let the people who are here speak, because I'm sure they have some other commitments as well, whether it be homework or correcting work or whatever it may be. So if you don't mind, you do have some documents in your folder, which are from Chris, about the trip. and about the planning for the trip. I had originally planned on Jeff getting up first to kind of open it up, but where Jeff isn't here, Chris, I'm going to look at you to open it up, to begin to talk about this, and also to begin to talk about some of the discussions you've had with the group, the parents, and where you are at this point, and also to offer people an opportunity to ask questions.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you for taking the time to see us tonight and consider our proposal. I'll also apologize in advance if I burst out into a coughing fit or two. I'm just on the finishing stages of a quite a bad cold, but hopefully I can get through this. I'm Chris Hayward. I'm the varsity baseball coach here at Cape Elizabeth High School. I've been here for 2 years, and I'm also a fifth-year math teacher here. I started coaching high school baseball in 1988 at Prescott High School, and that was the first year they, as the JV coach, that was the first year they started going on an annual trip to Florida. And over the next 3 years, 89 through 91, I went along with them as an assistant coach. And those are just amazing experiences. Those are rich memories that I hold clear to my heart, and would always hope and have the chance to be able to do that again. I coached varsity baseball at Wayne Fleet for a couple of years, but with a program that only had 10 to 11 players. It really wasn't deep enough to be able to take kids on a substantial baseball trip. So now that I'm here, and I'm very happy here, and hoping to keep the program going in a great place, I'd like to afford the opportunity to take the varsity team on. I don't really like to say varsity, but the uninvited group to go to spring training in Florida. The way I've looked into many options, our original plan was to go and stay in hotels and using Troy Henninger as a contact person to play local area high schools, that he would hook us up with. But their state tournaments changed over the last year, and they got moved up a week, so that week of our vacation they're in the tournament, so no longer afforded that opportunity. So the next thing we looked to do was look at different baseball facilities, and we've looked in South Carolina and Florida and Arizona. In Florida just seemed to have the best options. The three that we looked at in Florida were the Disney Complex, the Cocoa Expo, and the Bucky Dent School, and we found that the Cocoa Expo is the one that's the most cost efficient. With it, you know, head coaches stay free as long as you're taking 16 players. While we're taking 20 athletes, so my trip is going to be paid for. We're estimating the total cost to be about $1,400 per person, and we've met with and invited all those that are going. From our Western Maine B champion team returning, we have 15 athletes return. So we extended invites to all those 15 returning athletes. And then we invited five extras, focusing on who exhibited commitment to baseball and certainly looking to take extra pitchers along, because if we're going to play six games in 6 days or so, we would need to have plenty of pitching. Because we also keep into consideration that we'll probably play one league game before we leave, and upon our return we'll have a league game. So I'm not going to sacrifice our one and two pitchers for exhibition games against top-notch competition versus a accountable game for when we get home. I have three chaperones, myself, my assistant coach Higgins, and Chris Newell, a math teacher at the school, will be coming along and staying directly with the kids. There'll be 20 that have expressed interest in going. And there are also some other parents going. I believe the Pierce family is going. Ken Pierce is with us, the baseball booster president. And the Piscopos are going, and a couple other families have said they may go, but they're not sure. So we certainly have plenty of chaperones there for the kids. Based on my experience from having been three times before with Prescott High School, I know the importance of having a structured day for the young men. So once I have a set plan for the order of how things get done. First, once we hopefully gain your approval, the next thing I'll do is send a deposit to Coco Expo to make sure we secure our place. And then we'll get airplane tickets, depending on you know what dates we can go. And then once we secure that, then we let Coco Expo know which times we want to play games. And then after we have our game and practice schedule set, we will then fill in with activities, going to some attractions or going to the beach or just having some downtime letting the kids decompress. To help, sir, to help alleviate the costs, we have said the baseball boosters are running a show from the Maine Hysterical Society, November 16th, starring Randy Judkins at the cafeteria at the middle school. They're doing that as a booster event, and in the event that we don't get granted permission to go, that will just go into the booster account. And if we do get permission to go, then that will be used to go towards the trip. We also are exploring having a dance, community-sponsored dance. Susan Garrity has mentioned that a few times, and we're looking into that. A big fundraiser for the spring, once the boys can become involved, will be to sell subscriptions to ESPN, the magazine. Those are really an excellent buy. It's a two-year subscription for $40, and we get to keep $30 worth of the sales, so that's doesn't take many sales to make money in a hurry for that. So if you're interested, let me know. Excellent gifts, Christmas gifts. I've made it very clear.
Do you sell for 40 and you keep 30?
Yes, we sell it, right. That's a 75% profit for the...
It's an interesting...
And it's 84% off the cover price. but if you're interested, you can see one of the parents of the athletes. But nonetheless, I've made it very clear many, many times to all the players that it's just an invite. It's just a chance for you to go play in Florida and play against maybe some of the best competition around. And it's not, you're not obligated. They're getting no pressure for me to go. If they decide that they don't want to go, and we've had two of the initial invitees decide that they didn't want to, which was fine, then they just stay home and play with the JVs for the week so they can still get their baseball opportunities in. And we've also made it very clear that if money is an issue for anybody, we'll be very certain that we'll find a way to make it happen for anyone involved. I have a letter that I've given to Mr. Thorek. I don't know if he passed along to you, but it's a letter from the families of all those that are invited. I'll just read it to you. Dear Board of Education, we are asking permission to allow us to travel to baseball spring training facility in Cocoa Beach, Florida during April break 2009. We would like you to know that we are committed to helping all of the invited team members who want to attend to make it happen. As a group, we are pledging to make sure no one will endure a financial hardship because of this excellent opportunity. We feel this trip will better our team through bonding and playing against competition across the country at a top-notch baseball facility. We are very excited to be a part of this trip. Thank you for your time and consideration, and noticing that we are united and committed. And it's from the families of all the invitees. Well, I think I've said quite a bit. I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Thank you, Chris. Questions for Chris?
I just have, I guess you've addressed it, but I just sort of wanted to put it in context, and it's probably unfortunate that we didn't get to the booster meeting report beforehand. I think it's a great opportunity, and I guess I turn to the boosters because I think, Ken, you were at that meeting, and we sort of heard, and the school board sort of heard, that between the middle school athletics, the fees there, I think more and more of the costs of the programs are going to individual parents and families. And so, and the school department is blessed to have boosters to support our programs. We couldn't have the programs that we have without the boosters. When we approve a trip like this, and you're coming to us at your request, we're now putting an additional financial burden on the boosters. And I know in particular the baseball boosters, the dugouts last year, you've done some great things for the baseball program. I'm assuming that has all factored into your decision process. because, and I'm guessing we're going to need you to do more things like that for the baseball program. So this just sort of ups the ante for what you need to raise. And we're hearing that a lot of the booster organizations are feeling the pressure. So I think it's a great opportunity. I guess I just raised that issue, and Ken, you sort of sat through those meetings. I guess I just want to hear you say that you've talked about that and that it's okay, because it does put pressure on all the boosters when we approve trips like this.
Yeah, could you come up so the rest of people could hear you?
I agree. I mean, I was at the booster meeting, and I've been involved in several different youth sports in the town, and I raised funds for the dugout project and for other programs over the years. And there's no doubt in the community our size, it's an issue, because you tend to have, as in any group, a limited number of people that get involved and that contribute. So it is an issue at all levels. What I've seen is an enormous commitment on the part of the booster organizations throughout the community, be it baseball or women's ice hockey or whatever. And we're blessed that we have a core group of people in each one that are willing to go out and to do that. I don't think, one of the things I think, I don't know if Chris mentioned or not, but the hope is that this trip we could establish as not an annual trip, but maybe every other year. And so that kids can aspire to this sort of participation. I think one of the things I'm most proud of Chris and the work he's done in just the 2 years here is that it's where I grew up, and I played baseball at, you know, Wii level all through college. When I was 8, 9, 10 years old, I didn't know who the high school baseball players were or the high school coaches. And one of the things that he's done is he's instilled in these guys, and Ryan Boynton's here for the team, a sense that you have to give back to the community. And they've been integrated at the lower levels with our AA program and our AAA and our Little League program, where they're coaching, they're umpiring, they do skill levels. And hopefully, as they get older, Ryan, you're going to come back and be a member of a booster organization and go raise funds, because you're going to know what everybody did for you. But I hear you, and I can tell you that to get this off the ground, we've got a lot of people working hard. And one of the things we really want to do, too, is we want the kids come spring. You know, I know Chris didn't mention it, but he's got some ideas for Saturdays. Instead of practice, they're going to go do bottle drives or whatever. But we want them to take an ownership responsibility in it, too, so that it's something that they feel a part of, both going on the trip, but also the financial commitment that they're going to make. So it's going to be an issue, I think, forever. It's one we've certainly talked about and that we're willing to make the commitment to, and hopefully we can make such a commitment that it'll last for a while.
Can I just ask a follow-up question? Are there any large baseball construction projects planned this year?
Instruction, you mean skill programs or?
No, like the dugouts.
Oh, no, thankfully.
So this would be the bigger fundraiser for the sport for this year, for this season?
I think so.
Far and away. Yes.
Yeah, far and away.
We are looking at moving the batting cage over near the first base.
Yeah.
Near the first base dugout, which is our dugout. So we have more access to
those. Are funds we've already raised, and it's minuscule compared to this sort of project.
Do you have a sense of how much the parents are going to end up paying per student versus the fundraising / booster?
You know, I mean, I know from a personal standpoint with our own son, we sat down and said, now, Will, if you want to go on this trip, we'd like to make, you know, we want you to earn half of this. And I have to tell you that watching these kids and how scheduled they are and structured their lives are, I'll be happy if he can get close to that through, you know, babysitting or doing other things. I mean, I do hope that parents just don't, you know, some parents will be able to afford the trip, they'll be able to write a check. The hope The hope is, though, that through these fundraising efforts, the money we raise will subsidize everyone, and that no player will be denied the opportunity to go if they need financial assistance. And we'll have a confidential system put in place where they can request that. So that's our main goal, is to ensure that no player will ever go because of lack of funds.
Okay. Any other questions?
I think the only other thing that I would ask is that I do look at the letter that you read signed by the families of all of these players. And I would assume that since they have signed this, that they are all in agreement that this is a good idea. And the reason I ask that question is I have heard that there were some people early on who were concerned. And I know there's been several meetings. I know Jeff was at a meeting and you have had them. So I just would like to be comfortable in assuming that all of these families are comfortable with the cost of the trip.
Right.
In doing this.
I think you can assume that.
Any other questions?
I'm just going to be the stickler for the trips, because that's the hat I wear.
Somebody has to be.
The application, or whatever, the letter, the request was not approved or signed by the principal or the athletic administrator. Is that a little glitch, Jeff? And Jeff is not here? I'm assuming you're recommending this trip?
Yeah, and I talked to Chris and just talked about it.
Okay, and I just want to point out one box you didn't check, and this is actually part of the school policy, is that all parents, obviously you have, but all parents who are chaperoning need to attend a volunteer training. Jail okay. trainers, volunteer training. Most okay. of them may already have done that,
right.
various, you only have to do it once, but they do need to, anyone who's an official chaperone needs to do that.
And is that a...
It's easy. Gail Schmader, the volunteer coordinator, runs them periodically. I would be willing to guess that most of the parents at this point have already, that are involved, have already gone on them. You only have to do it once when you're involved in the schools.
I didn't realize that.
Gus might want to check.
Very good. Thank you.
It would pay to check with Gail, or she can tell you, or the people going, who has and who hasn't.
Sure.
She will always do a special training just to make sure that happens.
Right. Yeah, right. She'll cater and come to you guys if you need, if there's three or four people that need it.
Okay.
It's easy.
Other questions? Okay, then we're looking for a motion on the consideration of proposed varsity baseball team trip to Orlando, Florida, April 16th through the 24th of 2009.
I move that we approve the request from the baseball, for the varsity baseball team to go to Florida on the dates as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Karen. Discussion? Questions? No? Okay. All in favor? 6-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We shall continue on because I don't see Jeff yet, right?
No.
Okay. Sorry, Jeff. I see you.
The other Jeff.
The other Jeff. Sorry.
So probably we should go back to 7A, which is the consideration to implement proposed energy conservation plan recommended at the last meeting. That plan is in your folder. It is news from the superintendent's office. It is the piece that was published on the website with the information that was necessary. I'm just going to speak very quickly. With this being on the website, I had 8 responses from community members and our school staff. I certainly won't read them all, but we'll just give you some feedback. One parent wrote that he is pleased that we're looking at heating costs, feeling that that's a very important thing to look at. Remembers that during a previous energy crisis, that move was made to 65 in the classrooms, and agrees that 65 or any other, oh, this is the other job, any other recommendation would be important. And so supported the discussions that are going to go on as far as room temperatures. The second one I had was from Matt Young, who works for the technology. And two things that he pointed out that we would need to look at is, number one, personal electrical appliances. We look at those from the perspective of how they are being used. We do have in teachers' rooms the necessary equipment for eating lunches, et cetera. The second piece he talked about were computers and printer turnoff, and we do need to look at that carefully, and I can give you a good example. The other night, trying to conserve energy, I turned off the printers in my office, not realizing they also work the airport, and so the next morning, I could not get them up, I could not use the airport. So we will have to look carefully as we make those decisions. And that's what he has recommended, that we do work with Gary and the group in order to, as we turn those things off, to make sure we aren't turning off equipment that will go down completely for other uses in there. I had one from a parent who has two middle-aged children, tend to be quite warm, and lowering the temperature to 65 degrees, she feels would help, so I give a strong yes to that. A teacher at the high school who mentioned two things is that, number one, please do not do a four-day school week, which is one I mentioned to you that I'm not very excited about either at this point in time. And the other one was, as you think about consolidation, think about consolidating programs into certain buildings and certain areas so you can compete, which is a part of the proposal that we have in front of us. I do have a fairly long one. This is from two teachers at Pond Cove. The turning down of the temperature, to be aware that the heat in the classroom is very inconsistent, which we know, and I've had some long discussions with Ernie about how we can manage that. I know even Rebecca and I talked about it, based on whether you're on the sun side or no sun side, what that does. And so I had the opportunity to sit with Ernie on Friday down in front of the computer to see how we can realign the management of these rooms to try to get this to remain at a certain level. So that's one piece. The other one was the turning down of the heat to 50 at night, and the question was, you know, teachers who stay late in the evening, can they regularly do that and still continue to work? And I think you'll remember I told you that we would warn them it'll be set at 50. They need to be aware of that and be dressed appropriately for that. Electrical appliances for classrooms, talked about the fact that lunch times are very short, but therefore those that equipment is used for that. Again, I look at it from the perspective of we can try to keep all of those things going, but that does not save us energy. And I think the job we have in front of us is to save energy, and so we need to look at all the possibilities. I'm recommending some other approaches, including solar electric panels, windmills, etc., which are being looked at. Heat pumps could be more efficient. I will tell you very clearly, I have met with Ernie several times. There is nobody in the system who has a better idea of how things work and what he needs to do in order to make sure they work even better. And there was one non-energy request, and that was during every major rainstorm, water is drawn into the air exchanges and then leaks through the ceiling. It's distressing to be in the building with trash cans and halls. Again, my sense is, and I tour the buildings quite frequently, that that is not happening. And if it is, and it's reported, Ernie is moving very quickly to do that. As a matter of fact, Tom has been having us there once a week, and we have been touring sections of the building just to see what the problems are. I think Tom would agree that Ernie is acting very quickly when there are other issues like that. So sometimes these issues are historical as opposed to current, and we need to look at that. Another one from a mother is saying, asking if this also means the community center, and talking about the fact that there is a child care licensing piece that talks about a minimum of 68 degrees Fahrenheit, 2 feet from the floor. And I think we've done some checking on that one, if I'm not mistaken. And the last one is from a parent who has a son in the third grade who said his son goes to school all winter long with a short sleeve shirt because it's so warm. So he's hoping by dropping the temperature we will even it out more specifically. So with that in mind, what I have presented to you before and what we need to look at is, number one, is to remove all electrical appliances, including refrigerators, coffee pots, microwaves, etc., from classrooms. No individual heating units should be placed in rooms, and ensure that appropriate appliances are readily available at the teacher, staff, faculty rooms levels. And again, Ernie is it will work very closely with people to make sure that we are maintaining the appliances that we need to have, and hoping that the appliances we are using are energy efficient.
and not just wasting money. Turn off all lights in the classrooms and other sections of the schools when the area is not in use. I would say to you right now, from my tours of buildings, probably about 65% of teachers do that. They do turn the lights off when they leave their rooms. They do shut their doors. They do take care of it. I would say we still have 35% who don't, but we have a lot of people policing that to make sure that happens. That does make a difference. We set the daily temperatures in all classrooms at 65 degrees. I have continually asked the question, is 65 too low or is 65 too high? I've continually asked the question because I hear it over and over again about the heat. At 65, some rooms are 72 and some rooms are 50. No, not, they don't go that low, but are down to 60. And so Ernie guarantees me, I talked to him again on Friday, that he is in the process of assessing every classroom in the system so he can manage that information. It will be very important, if you accept this, that I start getting notices out to parents as soon as possible, and teachers, as far as that goes, about dressing appropriately during the winter months. I would tell you also, if we look at these changes as far as temperature, to be when the time changes, because that's also when the cold begins to appear. And so to try to manage that. I did ask that that besides addressing this with the supervisors, we will take a look at every thermostat, and heat sensor in the building to be sure they are working appropriately. We'll limit after-school access to buildings. We have looked at the high school and how we can limit it to most of the access being to the lower floor because of basketball practice, et cetera, and also any meetings to be on that floor and not keep the upper two floors open. Looking at Pond Cove as being used very infrequently, if not at all, and the middle school the same, except for, again, basketball practices and having specific entrances and exits. Therefore, Janet has been working with the custodians as far as where they clean and cleaning a specific area and shutting that area down for the night with lights and everything else and not having every building with lights on in every corner of it during the evening. Staff who is staying late will know that custodial services will be coming to their area and they need to understand that the custodians are on a schedule and will clean the room with them in there. Or if they don't want them to clean the room, then the room will not get cleaned for that evening. All computers, copiers, printers, et cetera, will be turned off completely at the end of the day, with the exception of knowing what other damage you might be doing, like I did the other night. So we will be checking each one to be sure there are instructions on how that is used. Students in buildings must be supervised by an adult at all times, and that adult must ensure prior to leaving that all lights are turned off and all doors and windows are appropriately shut and locked. And that is an extremely important piece. As we know, doors and windows that are left unlocked can bring trouble. And so that will not only keep us from having problems that we might have had last year, but also ensure that the building is well taken care of. And I did talk about the possibility of 4-day week. I feel very strongly that unless the state itself begins to turn to that process, I don't see a 4-day week helping us tremendously. Now, that doesn't mean that by looking at the cost of driving buses, cost of people coming in, that may be a savings, but I think that is one we need to do some very specific work on before we make any decision like that. So those are the basic ones that I've given to you in order to look at them and decide how do you want us to proceed with further savings of energy monies.
What are the evening hours that you're talking about that you're going to turn the temperature?
What we're looking at is that for the building itself, it will shut down 1 hour after the last students have left. Evening hours, like let's say the bottom floor of the high school. I always say bottom because I always get it mixed up between us, the third floor, the first floor. But the bottom floor of the high school would be kept at a 60 to 65 level if it is being used for practices, student work, those types of things. So we would, and as long as Ernie knows it prior to, he can have the computer manage it from that perspective. And he actually showed me how to do it. Don't worry, I won't be doing it. But
what about the other, what about the classrooms that, I guess that's what I'm talking about.
At the end of the day?
Right.
Yeah.
When the temperature changed
take effect.
Yeah.
Are we talking 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock?
If it's at the high school level, your kids leave at what time, Jeff?
2:30.
So by 3:30, or at the latest at 4 o'clock, the temperatures will drop at that point in time.
So as a follow-up to Linda's question, how does community services fit into this? I know there's driver's ed there, there's community service classes, and they meet in the evening on the third floor of the high school. Is all of that getting shifted?
Yes. Do you want to speak to that, Janet, if you do, that's fine.
We met, Ellen and I met early in the summer, and we talked about this prior to our brochure going out. So we have consolidated our classes to meet this. And one piece that Alan didn't speak of is that not only the first floor of the high school, but there is a core center on the second floor, which is the library, the computer lab, the faculty lounge, and that classroom that used to be the Mac lab that's been made into a classroom. Those areas will be still open for parent meetings and some of our classes. And the majority of community services classes are also in our building, but the driver ed will be moved to the second floor.
What effect is this going to have on our janitorial staff, too? I mean,
and that's why I wanted to get you while you were up here.
Thanks. we're shifting to team cleaning. So the hope is, and I say hope because we're still working on it, that they will trash out the entire building while the faculty is still present so that they can get that personal touch and get the opportunity to speak to them. And then they will shut down the building, and when they clean an area, they will open that building, clean that area of the building, clean it, and lock it back down, and then go to the next area, open it, clean it, and lock it down, so that it should not affect the energy saving plan.
Right, but I mean,
we're going to be cleaning in 50-degree weather.
That was where I was going with this.
The temperature, I'm told, the temperature will not go down to 50 degrees for a couple of hours after it's turned down, and they should be able to, with a team cleaning concept, finish the Pond Cove before that temperature has dropped to that level, and then they can consolidate their efforts into the areas that are still at the higher temperatures. Likewise, in the high school, with 2 to 3 people, they'll be able to knock out the third floor while the temperatures are still higher, and then they'll be able to go to the areas of the building warmer and finish at the first floor, which doesn't get locked down until later in the day.
First, as a quick aside, I think that's a great fundraising thing for people that can start knitting mittens for Getty ESPN magazines. Is it now, is there one night a week where none of the buildings are used? Is that when you're scheduling people? Is that going to be a major difference?
Buildings are presently used pretty much every night of the week.
That's what I was thinking.
Which is why we, initially when Alan had this plan, it was to close down buildings completely. But looking at it, that was too difficult. So we then just consolidated whatever meetings occurred in those buildings to certain areas where Ernie could then shut down the rest of the building and just heat and light just certain areas in each building.
So I'm just wondering if you're asking us to approve this, I don't know if that one's pertinent anymore. Because for example, you know, the community services or the travel basketballs that play in the middle school gym, are you going to be able to accommodate them by only keeping, like this particular statement says, close all the buildings one night per week with the exception of the lower level of the high school? Will that accommodate those other groups?
The plan was, and I'm not sure how that was worded, but the plan was that the Pond Cove gym, middle school gym, and the high school gym would not fall under that closing.
So does it matter? Do we need to get to that level of detail?
We can realign it at that point in time. Where we are right now is we have had these discussions about what we're going to do, but we haven't gone any further until I can hear where the board is on this. And so once we get some direction from you then we will be sitting down to finalize all of these plans. But early on, when we started this, we had looked at closing all buildings down for one night at least per week. But when we began to look at the schedules, we realized that is not going to happen. So what we realized then is that we do need to set up meetings and places for meetings so that they are concentrated in one area so major pieces of the building can be shut down. And so Ernie took me through a drawing of how all the piping goes, and so therefore we can make decisions based on certain areas of where the piping goes in order to shut down certain areas and keep other areas open at a lower temperature.
We do plan on reducing and eliminating a good part of the Sunday use as a result. Trying to make that be a date that is not utilized.
I'm thinking that still might be a challenge for some of the travel basketball groups in particular.
Travel has not used the gyms on Sundays in our facility.
Okay, I was going to say because most of the games are on Sundays, but they're not.
They're not in our facility.
I have a question. When you rely on people to do some of these things, you're putting additional pressure on them, and I don't want to, pressure is the wrong word, but some of these things could be set to go automatically, and I know you've heard me say this a couple hundred times, but motion sensors that turn those lights off when there's not motion in the room, and I don't know if that works in a classroom. I mean, I don't know if there's a point in time when the classroom is so not moving that the lights are going to go off. Now, I think some of those are more sophisticated, so they can be turned on and held on, but those types of things would shut things off. Thermostats, they shouldn't be accessible, and I think we talked about that. Maybe you had talked with Ernie, and
yep.
They're not accessible.
They're not. Yep.
They shouldn't be accessible by any staff except for his folks and how he aligns that. And
they're all now controlled by the computer.
By the computer. Yep. And also, you know, if we can put this plan into place, but if we don't have folks that are actively charged with making sure that it's monitored. So, for instance, if you said maybe we're not going to have coffee pots in certain, you know, in classrooms or whatever, and that all is great for about 2 weeks, and then they sort of kind of start slipping in here and there, and, you know, you're saying we don't want them there, then we got to make sure that Ernie and or whoever you decide is actively going out and keeping this program alive. And I also had another question at one point. You were talking about a burner conversion at the middle school. Is that still some? No.
No.
Okay.
Not at this point in time. It was too expensive.
Okay.
To make the conversion.
I knew that it was expensive, but I didn't know.
I would tell you that Ernie has worked at getting light sensors into areas where they work the best. And so we have them in many areas of the buildings. We do not have them in classrooms yet. We have them in bathrooms. We do have them in other areas of the buildings. He is going to try some others. They are expensive, and so we're doing it on a basis of trying them out in different areas, see how they work, and then add from there. But probably the entire work of sensors, the ones we can use, will probably take a couple of years to make all of the changes we need to do. From the perspective of what is in classrooms as far as refrigerators, coffee pots, etc., the custodians of all three buildings have done a census for us of what is out there, and they are just waiting now for some guidance from the board to know if that is going to be how we do it. And at that point in time, then they will be removed. And at the same time, Ernie is doing the checking for us to make sure we have the appropriate equipment available in teacher rooms so they'll have them.
I have another question, and I think it more pertains to the high school, but and I know we've talked about outside lights and having them on when there's things going on, but I know myself personally, I have experienced a lot of being in the building, leaving the building, and there are no outside lights on, and it's pretty dark. Now, I don't know if sensors is the answer there, or it may not be. I mean, you may have a leaf or a branch blow by and turn those things on all night long. I don't know. But I know that when there are people in the building, leaving the building, there should be lights in the parking lot for security, if not for other reasons. And I've been concerned about safety several times, just in going, in leaving school board workshops, it's been very dark.
And I've recently had that conversation with Ernie. And so what he needs to do and what he is working on is to be sure he has the schedule so that he knows that on Tuesday, the 28th of October, there's a school board workshop, and therefore the lights will be set so that they will stay on at a later time and then go off. So he is working his way through all of those changes so that they will be ready to manage that.
And if we miss that somehow, like I know somebody mentioned the dance, that there were no lights after the dance, and if we miss that somehow, is there a way that the building administrator or whoever Jeff has assigned can override that when somebody says, oh my gosh, we got a parking lot full of kids and it's dark out there? How do we address that? Because I know this isn't an energy piece, I've sort of gone off on a tangent, but it concerns me.
I think there may be...
Jeff, can you do it over there, please?
Thanks, Jeff. Sorry. Sorry to pull you out.
I actually think that there is, Kathy, but to be honest with you, I don't. Has there any mention that we're having weekly meetings to talk about building issues and actually the issue of safety because lights are not being on? So I think that clued Ernie into, he had to go back and check what the sort of default time is, and he's thinking that he thought it was one time and it may be a little bit earlier than he thought, so he was going to go back and sort of switch it by half an hour, I believe, and then adjust, as Alan says. I think there may be, because I think he mentioned, specifically in response to some questions about the dance, that there may be a way that we can override. I don't know what that is now, but he's talked about sharing that with us.
You know, I can see him setting it up. He doesn't realize there's a dance. You are there. You realize there's a dance. There's no lights on, and, you know, five people come up to you and say, Mr. Shedd, there's no lights on outside. You should be able to have a way of, you know, turning them on, you know, like now, and
yep.
Taking care of that. Not looking for Ernie, who's, no, maybe not in the building. No. Okay, thank you.
Yep, sure.
I think an important piece, though, that Jeff just said that I want to reiterate is we used to have support staff meetings once every 2 weeks with Conco Middle School and High School. We have changed that this year because we found that there are issues specific to the buildings. And so with Jeff, we meet with Ernie and Janet and Pauline and myself every Friday at 2:00 to review the schedules for the week, et cetera. We just started that this year. With Tom, we're doing that every Wednesday, 3 out of 4 weeks, and we are doing the same thing, looking at schedules, but also inspecting buildings. With the middle school, we're doing it once a week, and again, taking a look at what is needed, what we need to do, et cetera. So we have changed that schedule, so we have more direct conversation with Ernie and with Janet about things that are very specific to the buildings. And, you know, knowing Janet, she brings the schedule for the building for the week so that we are well aware of it. Jeff Thorick has not been included yet, but that might be a wise way to look at it at least once a month just to see where we are on schedules. But we are trying to make all of these changes so we can take a look at these pieces as we make the changes.
And Kathy, at any point when the lights aren't on in the outside, if you just speak to the custodian, they can override and take care of that for you.
Okay, thank you. Good to know. Thank you. I don't mind if I trip, but yes.
I'd like to talk about the 65-degree part.
Mm-hmm.
I had a little experiment in my own little office. Several occasions, reducing my temperature down to 65 degrees. Because I have very strong recollections of working in Ukraine where heating systems didn't work very well and it got cold, and how difficult it was to concentrate on your work when it's cold. But I didn't remember how cold it was, so I tried to recreate it in my office, and I personally found 65 degrees to be very cold. My fingers were not very effective. I was constantly trying to keep them warm. I think it might be a tad extreme for what we're trying to achieve in our schools. I think that if Ernie can get this balancing issue under control, although being in a family with an HVAC fellow, I know that that's a pipe dream. There's never a perfect balance to any HVA system. And I think we all need to. I think we've all worked in professional, non-professional buildings, and you've always got one or two rooms that are too hot or too cold. But so it's a continual process that the building maintenance people have to deal with. But having said that, I think we're throwing a lot out there in terms of energy, ways of saving energy. I would like to propose, I wish Ernie were here, because what I would like to know is, he has said in the past, one degree change saves this much energy. I don't remember what it was, but it was pretty substantial. Because he actually came to, we actually talked about reducing the temperature probably about a year ago, and he talked about that to us. So I would like to propose that we do not go down to 65 degrees right off the bat. I think that we have a number of proposals in front of us that make sense, that are easy to do, and that will not interfere with learning, and that we consider an in-between step and give it some time and see how much of an impact we are having on our energy usage. Obviously, we can't say energy cost savings, because we all know what our costs are doing. But just in terms of usage, what do these proposals do to our usage? I'm not particularly wedded to a temperature, but I'm thinking, 67, 66. I'm willing to try 66, but 65 was cold. And so I would like to know if the board would be willing to consider moving off of 65.
So if we were looking at this proposal as a package, you would not be in favor of it as a package because of the temperature piece?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Question. Is the 65 degree, would it be set in stone if this was to be passed? Because I think it would make sense. I think the fluctuations in temperature really have an effect on learning capacity. And just as much as a really cold temperature, a really hot temperature has an effect and creates kind of like drowsiness or sleepiness, and I found that in a lot of classrooms I get that at any point during the day. So I don't know if there needs to be more research, and we as students would be willing to get some feedback from students if we try different temperatures, or I don't know if 65 is too low to start out with. Or
the hot rooms have nothing to do with the minimum temperature. It has to do with the fact that the system's not balanced. Mm-hmm. For whatever reasons, and it's beyond my capacity to explain how actually this could happen. It seems illogical to me, and my stepfather's never been able to explain to me how this actually physically can occur. But you set a temperature, a minimum. The rooms are set at 68. Okay. Now, 68, the system is set at 68 right now. Mm-hmm. Those rooms that you're in are not 68. They're a lot higher than 68.
72,
yeah, maybe even more than that. So we're not going to solve this problem by reducing the temperature to 65. What you're going to do is freeze those other rooms that don't have this imbalance that's causing the room to be really hot.
Really cold rooms and really hot.
Yeah. So I know Ernie's aware of it. I know he's trying to do what he can, obviously by actually rebuilding a room that's really cold. That's helpful.
How did we come up with the 65-degree number in the first place?
What we looked at is where we are now, and tried to make some decisions on where do we want to go if we are looking at some major savings. So these were only proposals. Okay. You know, from my perspective, that 65 could be 68, it could be 72. But it was just looking at some possibilities for the board to take a look at and then give us some guidance from there as far as where we go with them. But you are right, and Rebecca has commented on that several times from the Pond Cove perspective, is again, according to where the room is located, sun side, shaded side, there is an effect there. There's no question about it. And Ernie is trying several possibilities to see if he can get some control of that and how that can be done.
If we changed the, I don't want to nitpick or anything, and I'm not trying to, but if we changed it to initially start with 65 with a review after a period of time, or in the indication of, an extreme issue, 65 for a month to be reviewed and discussed by the people that you feel, whoever that is. Is that something that you would be more comfortable with, Rebecca? Because I know it sounds like 65's it, we've done it, 65, and we're going on, and we're not reviewing whether that was a good decision, bad decision, or it needs to change by anything.
Well, perhaps you want to go the other way and look at a higher one and see how that reflects in the classrooms. And if that is showing it continues to be too warm, then perhaps move it down. Like Rebecca said, there is a difference in every degree we move it down or move it up.
Because I know you said here the temperature is set at 70, and that's not true. It's been 68 for quite some time.
Well, I think you'll find that most of them average out to 70. And that's what he gave me for information.
So if that's that, if he set it 68 and it's averaging 70, then if you set it at 65, do we assume it will average 67? Or is that not
that's
a good
an
assumption?
Average. You've got extremes, and you have extremes on both sides. Averages aren't really all that helpful for me, because you've got people in discomfort on either end. So, you know, actually, Kathy, I'm fine with that. I think it's going to need to be more than a month because I don't think we've quite hit the really cold. But I'm fine with setting temporarily, bringing it down that low, and then getting some feedback from people. You know, that's
Trish,
okay.
I like Alan's suggestion, taking it in steps. And I would actually even ask, based on the concern for the janitors that was brought up earlier, do we want that greater disparity between daytime and evening temperature? Does it, if it goes down to 50, does it work harder to get back up to 65? Do you know what I mean? That's probably a naive heating question.
There's a point there.
Because it's a question that Ernie and I talked about the other day in the morning when we are trying to move from, let's say it's down to 50, to get it up to a temperature that is reasonable, that you'll probably have to start earlier in the morning but bringing the temperature up so that when the school opens with classes, the temperature has come up to wherever you're going to go to.
But he believes that still will be more efficient.
The
Ernie. Does Ernie believe that setting it at 50 at night and having to have it turn on earlier in the morning to bring it up to a temperature that is habitable is still more efficient than what we're doing right now?
I think his view of it is that we haven't tried any of those things, he was looking at trying it. But I think, again, Ernie's in the same boat I'm in. We're just trying to decide where do we go. If you want it higher, we can do that. I just need some guidance from the board so that we are all on the same page with this as far as how we're going to go ahead.
You want a motion?
Yes. I was just going to ask for
I would move that we adopt, I'm playing with words here, the superintendent's recommendation for energy savings with the exception of doing this in incremental steps. So putting the daily temperature down to 67, and up to Ernie's discretion on the nighttime temperature, however that is most efficient in terms of making it hospitable and habitable during the day, and also reworking the wording on the gym.
Number six,
as we talked about. And finally, in conclusion, that this would be adopted and implemented incrementally, and that it would be reviewed by the superintendent on a monthly basis and the board less frequently.
As needed.
Well, thank you.
And the removal of number 10, perhaps?
The four-day week?
Yeah.
Since we've addressed that, yes, you could take that out.
So that's all right to take that out.
So you're talking about 67. Is that correct?
Yeah, with I guess I'm emphatically adding that we should be monitoring that. If the temperature's at 67 and the buildings are at 70 or 69 as they are, maybe we lower it.
So if the superintendent is reviewing this on a monthly basis, then you could conceivably, Ernie could report back to you that the buildings at 67 are actually at X.
Mm-hmm. I think also, could I add an addendum that to take Andrew up on his comments that I think it shouldn't be just Ernie. I think we need to get a sense from teachers and staff and students what it's like in the buildings under these conditions. Does anyone remember what I said to second or not second that motion?
I'll second.
I've got the notes.
I'll second. It's recorded, Trish.
Quick question. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I don't know who can answer this, but or if this is even relevant. all three buildings, the middle school, the Pond Cove, and the high school, do they all run on the same relative percentage of energy efficiency? So like you said, this building runs on a 94% energy efficiency. Do all of them run on the relative?
I think what we're finding at this point, because of the reconstruction that was done at the high school 4 years ago, 5 years, 4 years ago, that as we get the system working appropriately, the high school is probably the most efficient. Pond Cove and the middle school, we have been making some changes. We recognize the fact, for instance, even at the high school, there's some old windows that allow air to get in, et cetera. So for efficiency levels, we have joined the town, and they are going to do an efficiency report on all of them. But I think you would probably find the high school, based on the controls we have at the high school, runs the most efficiently of the three.
Now, I know we had some confusion about bullet number six. I don't know if you talked about this with Ernie. Would it make sense to accommodate all groups or consolidate all groups into one school and close off two other schools?
We had talked about the consolidation mainly at the high school, with the understanding that because in the wintertime we do have a middle school basketball team, that they need to have a place to practice, and we know already how heavily booked the high school gym is.
Okay.
So we have worked out an entrance into the high school, which will be the single entrance. Right now, oftentimes, every door in the high school is open at night. Mm-hmm. We're going to stop that. We'll have just one entrance, which I think is number 7, in order to get into the gym to do that. So, and then we look at Janet and what is requested from the community center. And so we are looking at trying to keep as much in the high school and as much on the lower floor as possible, with the middle floor library, teachers area, et cetera, used for meetings like school board meetings and those types of things. I think one of the things we're trying to get away from, oftentimes when I go to the high school to get ready for the second meeting of the month, the workshop meeting, what I am struck by is there are often groups of students in rooms all over the building as I try to find custodians, et cetera. And so what we're going to try to do is move those again down to that lower floor, so that all floors of the building aren't open.
Alan, I know last month, when we first talked about this, I had a question about whether you could get an estimation about how much it costs the district to hold these spaces open for the non-school related programming. And whether it made any sense at all to try to figure out what that cost was and see if it could be included in the overhead that the community services puts towards the fees that they charge.
And that is a question. You had also mentioned that to me last week, I think it was.
I reminded you.
Yes,
gently.
You did. And Pauline and I, prior to Pauline leaving, we talked with Ernie about getting some of that information. And what we need to do is to set with Janet to kind of sort those pieces out, and we will do those.
Okay.
And because we did talk about how we manage that.
Because I'm not saying it has to happen. I'm just curious what that dollar figure is, and is it worthwhile then to pursue that?
Yeah, definitely.
Other questions, comments? Are we clear on what the motion and the second were? Are we clear on what the motion is?
Can I just, from my perspective, what I think you're telling me to do is to start at as far as temperature goes, on number 3, to start at 67, to monitor that and see how that is working, both highs and lows, and to talk with Ernie about discretionary information about 50 degrees at night and how that would work and how we might realign that throughout the buildings by controlling the heat. You're looking at 6 and reworking the wording so it does not talk about one night per week where all buildings are completely closed, and make that language a little more appropriate to what we're doing. And I crossed out number 10, and then Trish added an addendum. Well, she added 2 things. To be reviewed by the superintendent on a monthly basis and report to the board as needed, and also an addendum to check with teachers, staff, and
staff
and students, that's what it is, about what it is like in the building as these temperatures change.
Okay. We're clear now on the motion? Is that what it, we, okay. Any other questions, comments? All in favor? All opposed? Okay. 5-1.
You got that, okay, good.
I do. Oops, breaking my pencil. Okay, should we move backwards, Alan? That didn't sound right.
Yes.
Jeff Thorax with us. Jeff, would you like to give us an update on the boosters meeting and bleacher project?
Hopefully, schedules will work so we can be on time and follow through. So, to begin, bleacher update. We're looking at a startup date of Thursday, October 16th. So, tomorrow, there will be a group in to remove a portion of the fence to allow access for heavy equipment to come in there and do some do the digging and pour the concrete. There will also be, speaking with Bob Malley, some safety fencing in that area. So essentially they'll be blocking off light pole to light pole, and then the front fence of the turf, which is the 4-foot fence, and then the, I believe it's a 6-foot fence, the taller outside fence. So there will be protective fencing and the permanent fence that's already in place now. So that should take about 5 days for the concrete phase. And then from that point, the crew comes in and starts the installation of the bleachers. And if weather cooperates and everything works well, according to plan, that should take about 8 days. So it's quite a bit faster than we anticipated. And they're planning on delivering the bleachers on October 21st, and the location for that will be on the lower parking lot by the pool, so I guess where they put the equipment for the turf when they install the turf as well. So that will be put in a safe place, and their equipment, their trucks, and any other maintenance vehicles or anything else that they may need in that area. And just a little bit about the bleachers itself. They're 18 rows high, which is similar to what our, in height, roughly about what our gym bleachers look like, to use that as a reference. It's AV accessible with 12 wheelchair spots, and it's about 138 feet long. It's we'll have a press box as well. We've just recently worked on a few plans to help kind of take care of the logistics that this may cause with parking and use of the turf field. A couple of things spoke with community services for their Saturday morning program, the Saturday morning soccer and their field hockey. We'll have a safety sort of site supervisor on site to help monitor, make sure the kids aren't climbing over fences and making sure that that's a secure and safe spot. This Saturday, we have potential field hockey preliminary game that we're going to try to push into the afternoon, so that we'll try to eliminate any of the distractions with noise and jackhammers or whatever may be in place there. We will move the team benches right now, which are on the flagpole side of the field, over to the opposite side, and then have the spectators use the side where the flagpole is, just because of that area that will be blocked off from light to light. And then also we'll be shutting down the parking lot now that is just in front of the turf field, the small little wraparound parking lot next to the tennis courts. So that will be closed down. Our pickup for student athletes for travel away games will now be in the IT section, another small parking lot just in front of the IT wing of the high school. I should have handed these out beforehand. That wasn't in the agenda, but I thought that might be helpful if you need to take a look. I'm sure you've seen that, but and that was the bleacher piece.
And you didn't use any technical language?
No, I learned a lot this afternoon on soil content and rock and a bunch of things that we've run into, but we're really excited. This is going to be a tremendous asset to the community, and, well, I think definitely something that we need in that area. That hill is cumbersome and treacherous right now, especially when it gets wet, so this will be, it's going to be terrific. It's aluminum, obviously, but then on the part of this bleacher that will face out towards the field, sort of that step, will be a maroon color, so it's going to really look sharp. I can't wait for this to get started. There will be some minor inconveniences, but I think we're trying to work through those, and in the long run, it's going to pay off, and people will be really pleased with it. And, again, like I said, it will be a real asset, I think, to the community. So that was the bleacher. I'd be more than happy to take a few questions there.
Go ahead.
I have an easy one. This is kind of an other Jeff question. Speaking of those minor inconveniences, isn't that small parking lot that's going to be closed off a student lot? I just know parking has kind of been on the front burner at the high school, and I was just curious to know during that intervening time.
It is a student lot, but actually I think we still have, since the renovation, we still have plenty of spaces.
Okay.
Students don't always recognize all of them, but there are lots of spaces around. So the loss of that temporarily will not be a major problem.
Thank you.
Linda?
I think I'm going to encourage our seniors to keep their car in that senior parking lot, and instead of driving the 100 yards down to that lower parking lot. The nice thing about that lower parking lot is there's enough room for the buses to turn around. So we're going to get the word out, which reminds me, that's a good question. We'll try to put information out in the Pond Cove and middle school emails that go out to the parents as well. And especially, I think, to the Pond Cove on that Saturday morning community service program where there are a lot of young children in that area. So if we can keep a lot of, you know, that supervision and just be extra cautious for the next couple of weeks.
That parking lot's being temporarily closed.
Temporarily for this project. Seven of those spaces will be no longer there.
Yeah, I remember that. I'm just thinking of, you know, for disabled folks.
Sure. And there is a section facing the high school that we could definitely use for that. We're, I think, more concerned with that row facing the turf field.
Right.
And a matter of fact, there will be safety fence on those seven parking spaces because there will be footings in place there.
Linda, you had a question?
Forgive me, but maybe it's my eyesight or the...
It is small. I tried to blow it up.
But it looks like total seating capacity on here is about 1,396. Is
correct.
That correct?
1,400. Oh, yeah, 1,398, I think it's in.
Okay. Thank you. Could be my eyesight.
It's pretty little.
And they're going to run approximately from, is it the 20-yard line to the 20-yard line?
Roughly. Visually, I think if you're looking at the lights just inside that area, so almost from light pole to light pole, probably... maybe 5 yards, maybe probably 10 yards inside of that as a vision, you know, if you're trying to look at where those lights are in comparison to where the bleachers will go.
Okay.
What's your completion estimation date?
They are hopefully looking at the end of the month, so possibly the 30th as a completion time, which would, again, I think that, you know, we hopefully will have a few playoff events, but I think there is enough space. We have that whole side by the flagpole, and then the two end lines portions as well. And like I said, I think it will be a bit of an inconvenience, but I think when we're seeing the construction going on, I think that may help the community a little bit, kind of forget about that aspect and think about all the good things that are going to happen.
So they're going to put these up between the existing fences that are there, correct?
Correct.
And those are going to stay in place during construction, or?
Aside from one section that they'll use for an entry. Yeah.
Okay.
And the bleachers will just, I think, essentially abut the small 4-foot fence.
Okay.
Any other questions for Jeff? Great.
All right. And then...
Status on the booster.
Sure. Oh, and before I forget, too, the
there is an override on that parking lot light. Mark Dougherty, one of the custodians, because I do turn them on for our nighttime athletic events. So Mark showed me in that second floor of the high school. I've learned a lot of the little of the nooks and cranny of that building, and found that there was a switch that we could turn on and off. We just have to remember to turn it back off because those lights will stay on. I will share that. It's in this. It's
you're
in
promising
this
to do that.
Storage room of the second floor there, and it's.
Don't disclose too much.
I know. It is. It's a little spooky.
Don't tell us where
there,
it is.
So.
Not on camera, anyway.
And then on the booster meeting, Alan, Jeff, Shed, and myself, and along with a few of the board members, met with all of our boosters. And I think our attendance was almost 100%. We had just about every booster representative there that has an official group. We do have a couple of athletic teams that don't have an athletic booster. So it was excellent attendance. Alan and Jeff opened up with reviewing some of the key policy points and spent some time reviewing some of those, and then I went into the focus topic, which was the current state of the athletic budget, and I distributed the athletic budget essentially, and we looked at not at each team specifically, but what the athletic department puts into the program financially, and I think that was an interesting lesson to share with the booster members because of the relationship that we have with them, with their contribution and the fundraising that they're doing in addition to what the school puts towards its athletic budget as well. And without them, I don't think our programs could succeed and do as well and be supported as well. We talked a little bit about the boosters contributing over $200,000 to the operating budget with all the different fundraising that they do and the support. And so with that in mind, we looked at the future and what are some of the key points to look at given the current state of our economy, what we went through with this past school budget, and just trying to look ahead. And some of the things that came up were just trying to prioritize our needs. Maybe that warm-up that we try to replace, that boosters like to replace or that teams like to replace each year, and maybe focusing on a longer-term goal, something where if we have a piece of equipment that may need to be fixed or replaced, and trying to prioritize those needs. So coming up with a possibly like a five-year plan and looking ahead instead of being spontaneous. Looking at, the discussion came up with multi-sport and single sport, or multi-booster, single booster organizations. And there was excellent discussion on both sides of the table there. Janet Hoskin came up with a fantastic idea of a booster council. So having a group, multi-sport boosters, but having an athletic council or a booster council that sort of oversees that and helps the athletic department, and I think works with the boosters and sort of a liaison, so to speak, and kind of bring both groups together, really look at the importance of major needs and looking at the athletic participation fee. And again, coming up with a plan that will best serve the school and the student athletes participating. So it was a really good meeting. I think there was excellent discussion and everyone was very supportive. And I think it was, something that I'm looking forward to doing again in the spring. When you're looking at the future, I think it's important to realize to look at what makes the Cape Elizabeth Athletic Program so special. We have 48 teams participating, and that's with a level of about 70% participation. So 70% of our high school students are participating each season. And that number, that you know, it speaks a lot about what we do as a program and just the interest and the passion that our kids have for being part of a team and competing. And with that, we have 16 different athletic offerings, of which 14 are boys and 14 are girl programs, so including some freshman teams as well. So it's very unique. We're looking at within the Western Maine Conference, the conference we belong to, that is, you don't see that kind of participation and involvement. So I think that's something, you know, that's very special about our programs here in Cape Elizabeth, and it sort of separates us, and it provides that opportunity for kids to participate and possibly try something that they may have not done before, and be part of a team and get those core character values, those life lessons that you learn from athletics, and again, that extension of what we're doing in the classroom. So that's a little bit about the booster meeting.
Thank you, Jeff. Any questions? Comments? Great. Thank you very much for doing that. Great communication piece with both groups.
The girls.
Jeff, there is going to be, very quickly, to talk about briefly about the girls' ice hockey team.
It's next.
That's next, if you want.
You can stay right there if you wouldn't mind.
Perfect.
Okay, so we are moving on to 7C on page 2. Consideration and action to form a cooperative girls' ice hockey team with Wayne Fleet for the 2008-2000 year, school year only. So that's the remainder of this year, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Do you want to let you maybe
sure.
speak to that, and then we can...
So at the last workshop, we sort of had a look forward quickly and try to provide some minutes of some sort or a letter to the Maine Principals Association to go ahead with to seek their approval in this cooperative agreement between Wayne Fleet and Cape Elizabeth for girls' ice hockey. So in your packet, I think there was a response from the Maine Principals Association, a letter dated September 30th, accepting or approving that relationship between the two schools. It's a two-year commitment. That doesn't mean we have to, we're not held or locked into that two-year commitment, so we can revisit this again at a later point. But it is a two-year agreement. We had an informational meeting with Wayne Fleet and the Cape Elizabeth girls ice hockey players, or anyone that was interested in participating in girls ice hockey. That was last week. We had roughly 8 girls from Wayne Fleet and approximately 20 or so girls from Cape Elizabeth. And then the Wayne Fleet athletic director was there as well. And we went over a few things, trying to, you know, the scheduling aspect and the sort of our goals and expectations. Doing some research since that last workshop meeting, spoke with Keith Weatherby and the athletic director again at Wayne Fleet, and learned through them that there was an agreement of some sort made to help help with the cost of the overall funds for that program. And the agreement was to take whatever that percentage of Wayne Fleet student athletes that were interested in playing hockey and coming and looking at what the school board budget was for the athletic, which was $6,400, and coming up with a percentage of that to contribute to that fee, so which was about a third, which equated to about $2,000. So that fee now, so that overall operational budget, or what the school's supporting and what Wayne Fleet's supporting, was around $8,400. And a total operational cost for ice hockey was around $20,000, $18,000, $20,000. So that would leave an additional $12,000 that the booster group would have to come up with. The booster group has a fee that they ask their girls to and families to pay, and that was $375 fee, which it covers additional ice time, transportation, and assisting coaches. That would leave, and that came, that would come up to about $6,300, taking that 375 times about, I think about roughly 20 girls. So that left about $2,000, and the booster group was confident in that their holiday pie sales and poinsettias that they do over the holidays, and they have a cookbook that they do as well, that cost would probably be taken care of. This is new to me and as well, so you know, it did take a little research to figure out, and I'm not sure if it was communicated correctly to the board, but I did originally, but I did find some of this information since that last workshop, and just wanted to share that with everyone. Thinking in going into that last workshop meeting that we just needed to really tidy up a formality. So glad that I was able to share that, the financial piece. I hope that's helpful in making this determination. And if there are any more, I'd be happy to try to answer any questions.
Linda?
You know, out of this remaining almost 12,000 that isn't funded by the schools, that would be booster funded, it sounds like Wayne Fleet's relying on the Cape Elizabeth boosters to come up with that remaining $12,000?
They, in part of the discussion was working with their booster group, so essentially bringing some of the events, that, like the poinsettias and the pies and the cookbooks, sharing that with the Wayne Fleet School as well, and doing some sales over there. They have a craft fair that they were looking into participating in over at Wayne Fleet, where they could possibly set up a table and get involved there. Those families would also, so the Wayne Fleet, the school itself wouldn't be funding the $2,000 additional. That would be coming from the families interested in participating in hockey.
Okay, so if they have nine players,
then
nine or ten players, if they charge the $375, that's already
so that yeah, in our percentage
that
yep.
would be.
And that percentage would move up.
So are they going to, I guess my question is, are they going to try and make the fees even? It doesn't matter if you're a Cape player, it doesn't matter if you're Wayne Fleet.
Yes.
The fee is going to be the fee, no matter what, which school you're
Correct.
From.
Correct, okay. Yeah. And that's where the percentage piece came into
okay.
play. And there is room for any hardships in place as well. For families that may need that assistance, and they could communicate that information with myself as well. And we brought that up, and $375, it is a lot of money. Ice hockey is an expensive sport. The ice time right now is a premium, and the arenas are really granted, there are some increased energy costs, but I think because of the premium of, you know, how important ice time is right now, they've definitely increased some fees there. I think ranges anywhere from $180 to $220 an hour.
Wow. Thank you, Jeff. Any other questions? Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the formation of a cooperative girls ice hockey team with Wayne Fleet for the 2008-2009 school year only.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Is there second.
A, thank you, Linda. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? 6-0. Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
Thank you. 7D, consideration of proposed science team competition trip from CEHS teacher Sean Garrett.
Mr. Shedd.
A.K.A. Jeff Shedd.
These are not new trips. For the last couple of years, we have had a science team that's been invited and allowed to participate in the North Shore Science League in Massachusetts. It's just a wonderful competition for our kids. 2 years ago, our students actually won the competition. We were afraid they might not invite us back, but they have invited us back. What is different here is that we're trying to, in line with opening up for the use of school buses within 125 miles or roughly their distance down to Boston, rather than renting vans and then having teachers drive the vans, which is not the greatest way to do it, although it's consistent with school board policy, having talked with Sean and sort of looked at the budget, we decided that we would go with school buses as a safer alternative. So that's really what this proposal is. I'm not actually sure technically it's even required to get school board approval since all the trips are within 125 miles, but that's what the proposal is.
Thank you, Jeff.
Sure.
Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the proposed science team competition trips from Cape Elizabeth High School teacher Sean Durash.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Trish. Discussion?
Question?
Yes?
Just a quick question. Is $25 enough? It says $25 per student. I think it's a great program. I was just curious if that's really what it costs, because it looks like you're making 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 trips.
There is some money that's in the school budget.
Okay.
So I think that's an amount of money in addition to.
Other questions? All in favor? 6-0. Okay. Are you doing the World Fairs Council trip
yes.
as well?
Yes. And the board is familiar with these trips. This is to the Harvard Model UN. It's December 11th to 14th. It involves the loss of the students missing one school day because it's scheduled largely around weekend. They will definitely miss school all day on Friday. It's possible, depending on how it can be scheduled, that they might miss a class or two at the end of Thursday, but Ms. McNulty is trying to avoid that. But most of the bulk of the activities are on the weekend. And it's been a well-attended and popular program in the past, and I think it's well worthy of the board's consideration. But this one definitely does need board consideration because this is an overnight trip out of state.
I remember that from the past, yes. Thanks, Jeff. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the World Affairs Council trip to the Harvard Model UN.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? 6-0. Thank you, Jeff. Trish, consideration of following policies for first reading.
Yes, these are first reading, so they don't require a vote. I'll quickly go through them and sort of highlight what our recommendations are. The first one is JB, which is equal educational opportunities. We're recommending that this is deleted because you can read the comments on there from Drummond and Woodsum, and doesn't match its title. The thing that we were concerned about when we read this was communication with parents, and that is covered in other policies. Policy JFAB, admission of non-resident students. We reviewed the MSMA version of this policy, and based on Drummond and Woodsum's comments, and we felt ours represented the current practice, so we'd like to recommend it as is. Interrupted study, JJH. We only had one edit, which is underlined and bolded, as you can see, and that was to minimize the disruption of a student participating in other programs. JKD, which is suspension of students. This was reviewed, obviously, with legal counsel, and the few edits that we're suggesting are bolded as well. JK, student discipline, this is a required policy. It's currently in compliance, and the only change after legal consultation was a change in the legal reference on page 2. JKA, corporal punishment and use of force, we're recommending this policy for deletion. Student discipline issues in here are covered in our JK, student discipline policy, so we do not need a separate policy. JKE, expulsion of students. This was okay. There was one particular area we verified with Drummond and Woodsum to make sure our current practice was in compliance with that, and we got the go-ahead, so we'd like to send this forward as is.
Thank you. So these will be reviewed at the next policy committee meeting.
Yes.
And
so if anyone has comments, the next policy committee meeting is next Tuesday, the 21st. If anyone has questions or concerns, they can either share them now or share them at the meeting or prior to the meeting.
And that will be at 12 o'clock in the Jordan Conference Room?
Right.
Okay. Great, thank you, Trish. Alan, consideration
on the schedule, I like that.
Consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for middle school extracurricular fee positions for 2008 and 2009.
You have that list in your booklet. It's a fairly long list for middle school coaches and high school coaches. Is that the one I'm doing?
You're doing
middle school extracurricular,
yes. Middle school.
So it's the middle school extracurricular piece, and I don't know if you want me to read it all the way through, or if you just want to ask questions on it, I'd be more than happy to try to answer them.
Why don't we go with questions, if anybody has a specific question for Alan?
I don't remember seeing talent show in the list of extracurricular programs in our, that seems just new to me. I don't remember seeing that before.
Yeah, we didn't have it for.
Thanks, Steve.
We didn't have the talent show for a two-year period, but it's been in the school every other year. So we're just putting it back.
In the budget?
Yes.
Other questions?
We shifted. We've got some that we dropped, and we've got others that we put back in. For instance, civil rights team, we couldn't get, we had one student in the civil rights team last year. The year before, we had four students. So depends on which ones are drawing students.
Mm-hmm. Other questions about the extracurricular? Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for middle school extracurricular fee positions for 2008-2009.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Trish, discussion? Question? All in favor? 6-0. Consideration of superintendent's recommendation for high school co-curricular fee positions 2008-2009.
I have two positions on this. One with Maura McDermott, the other one with Larry Allen. Again, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Questions for Alan? No? We have a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for high school co-curricular fee positions for 2008-2009.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Linda, thank you. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? All opposed? 5-1. Okay, consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for high school athletic positions for 2008 and 2009.
And I have two there for Tim Thompson and Tim Lawson for the high school. Both volunteer positions.
Thank you, Alan. Any questions for Alan? Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation for high school athletic positions for 2008-2009.
Thank you, Rebecca. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Questions? Comments? All in favor? 6-0. Consideration of superintendent's recommendation for district co-curricular fee positions mentor teachers for 2008-2009.
I have a list that was done by Mary Bruns. These are recommendations for mentors for new teachers. You have 8 of them listed. Showing the teacher and the purpose of it. Again, I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Questions? Oh, Trish?
Just a quick question.
Yes.
This is required,
yes.
Correct, by legislation?
Yes.
Other questions? Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendations for mentors for new teachers.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Discussion? All in favor? All opposed? 5-1. Consideration of requests for extended leave of absence during 2008-2009 school year for Pond Cove teacher Morgan Burns.
You have a letter in your packet dated September 11th, 2008, from Morgan. She is expecting a child, but we haven't added a level of concern here, as her husband has also been assigned to overseas duty. And so because of that, she is asking that she be allowed to take the remainder of the year off. There'll be unpaid leave except for what comes under the maternity leave issues at that point in time. So she is looking for the remainder of the year off just to manage both a new baby and the fact that her husband will be on overseas duty. As it happens, I believe he'll be in the Philippines, if I'm not mistaken.
So it would start in December?
Her due date is December 21st, so it'll happen as close to that as possible.
Through June of 2009?
Yes.
Okay, and do we have plans for someone to substitute for her? Okay, thank you. All right, thank you. Is there a motion?
I move that we accept, I guess, the superintendent's recommendation that we approve a leave of absence for Morgan Burns.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Karen? Discussion? Questions? All in favor? All opposed? I'm sorry, Peter, I didn't get...
I'm in favor.
Thank you. Okay, page three, we're making progress. Consideration of appointment of school board member as delegate to the Maine School Board Association, MSBA Fall Conference. If you recall, we had tabled this last time, pending the, we didn't have the information about the Fall Conference, and we weren't sure if anybody was going or not. So, I believe that no one is going. Is that correct? Do we have no takers at this point? So this is sort of a moot point. I don't think we need to appoint anyone since no one's going to be there. Is that all right? Is that all right if we indefinitely table this?
Okay. Some will.
Thank you. Okay, well, we'll do it that way. All right. Anybody want to second that permanent table?
Second.
Thank you, Trish. All in favor? 6-0. All right, great. Is there any committee reports that people feel are important that they want to share with folks while we're on camera?
Yeah.
Rebecca?
I need to share the Finance Committee report.
Yep.
So we met on September 24th at 8 o'clock. Myself, Trish, Peter, Alan, Pauline, Kathy, and Sue Buckley. We reviewed the food service program, and I regret to tell you that it ended the year with a negative balance of nearly $60,000 and required a transfer from the general fund balance. The committee discussed with Sue Buckley its grave concerns about the food service's financial management and the need for a financial plan and analysis for the coming year to avoid a similar result in 08-09. This plan is going to be presented to the committee at its next meeting, which should be in about a couple of weeks. It was also noted that recent changes in the way the elementary school students were handled in the cafetorium resulted in disincentives for purchasing lunches, and this is going to be discussed with the staff at Pond Cove. I think that we appropriately conveyed our concern to the administration about the food services program, and we're going to be very interested to see what specific recommendations are going to be made to avoid this from happening again. We also looked at energy and was informed at that point that $3.41 was locked in for heating oil at 90,000 gallons, which would put energy costs at roughly $20,000 over budget. The committee decided that given that this is a known overage, Pauline and Alan would locate $20,000 from other expense lines to transfer to the heating oil line. And we'll present the recommendation to the committee and then for school board approval. I have subsequently just asked a clarifying question via email to Pauline that given the incredible drop in oil, whether that lock-in price is now negotiable. So hopefully Paulina's going to be able to get back to us about that in time for our Finance Committee meeting. Ernie also submitted a report to us showing that with lighting changes that he has made, the district has already saved 39,000 kilowatts, or roughly $5,450.
Questions for Rebecca? Anybody else want to chime in on their committee reports?
Trish? Actually, just really quickly, something that will be coming up. The Policy Committee, and with Gary's help, we've devised a survey on the substance abuse policy, which has been in place now for 3 years. Because it's been administered for 3 years, we'd like some feedback, particularly following some of the conversations and meetings that have taken place at the high school. That should be on the school website in the next week or two. So we'd welcome feedback from students, parents, teachers, other community members. So please check the website for that in the next couple of weeks. There hopefully will be a link, and it'll be obvious that it's there.
Thank you, Trish. Anyone else? No. Okay. Public comment on agenda items. I don't think I see anyone. School board agenda requests. And we've had that long conversation. Is there a request out there? Okay. Announcement of upcoming meetings, which they are on the website, so I'm not going to bother to go through them. If nobody else has anything, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. How many people want to second it?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Usually everyone does. All in favor? 6-0. Thank you very much.